So in this segment, we're going to be talking about Labour cannot make people's lives better until it dares to start talking about Brexit. This from Stella Creasley, a backbencher in the Labour Party. I did see someone who was very critical of this article, saying Labour needs to focus on swing seats and swing voters. Again, I think elections are a lot more about what, you know, a few people believe in certain seats. You have to energise your base as well. If you look at one of the reasons why the Tory party won a stonking majority is they took the traditional heartlands from Labour. And that's how they won their majority, such a large one as well. So it's more than just, you know, focusing on swing voters and opinion polls and all of this stuff, approval ratings. It's about energizing your base as well as taking votes from the centre. You know, that's my opinion anyways, but that's his thoughts. Not going to call him out on it just yet, because I don't think it warrants a call out. But if you know who I'm talking about, then fair play, just don't mention his name. So she says, the political silence about what effect leaving the European Union is having on medicinal supplies has hit hard. The experience is not unique, whether it is businesses overwhelmed with red tape, care homes missing staff, or rising food prices. The public are asking why such difficulties keep happening. So if you look at each one, right, businesses and red tape. So in terms of exporting and importing, there's Brexit red tape there. Now, importing is easier than exporting. Purely because the exporter deals with a lot of the stuff, and the fact that the UK's border checks are nowhere near as stringent as the EU's are. Care homes missing staff, again, that's down to the way the system is set up for care homes and the fact that we have no freedom of movement. Working in a care home is very difficult. They are very much underpaid. So that's something that really has to be looked at. Rising food prices, again, we're seeing the farms are planting less and they're still having staff shortages. So what that means is less food is picked in the UK, which means we have to import more. The pound is weaker against the euro and against the dollar, which makes imports more expensive. You're seeing fuel prices go up as well, which is not really Brexit related, but what you're also seeing is because of the import customs fees, shops are having to pay, you know, the customs fees, etc., and that cost gets passed on to the consumer. So again, Brexit plays a large part in the rising food prices. The public asking why such difficulties keep happening, it's because the public elect idiots. That's why, Stella, just letting you know. And finding that MPs are avoiding giving honest answers, let alone a solution. Yeah, that's another problem. It's not just, you know, the Tories, the Labour are doing it a bit as well. But the Tories keep claiming this has nothing to do with Brexit when, you know, other countries are facing issues. Yes, they are having staff shortages, etc. But we're doing a lot worse than most other countries, especially since we have the highest inflation in the G7. And we're having active food shortages in supermarkets. If you go to the fresh fruit and vegetable aisle, it's not looking too promising. For fear of saying the wrong thing, many in Labour claim it is better to say nothing at all about Brexit. It's because Labour don't really know what to do. They want to appeal to the red wall, but at the same time, they want to, still want to keep their traditional voters as well. I guess kind of the newer kind of voters, you know, university educated people, the minorities, people that are pro-EU as well. So Labour has no idea what to do. But such reticence does not honour those who voted leave or remain. Post-Brexit, there are many ways forward for the UK and the EU, and most don't end in a trade war as a distraction from a Prime Minister's personal misconduct, which is true, that there are things the UK can do. These are equivalency and alignment deals, but again, Labour aren't really talking about that much, which is annoying. Silence also means Johnson gets to define what, if any, future relationship Britain can have with Europe, and that's important. It's the person who comes out and sets out their policies typically can set the pace. And what at the moment, Johnson is setting the pace here. He's the one saying, the EU are causing all these problems. You know, Britain has to keep fighting the EU over Northern Ireland, etc. They're trying to retake Northern Ireland, blah, 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 all this nonsense, right? The problem is if Labour don't combat it and set out their own kind of ideals and agenda and really go after Tory party arguments, it makes it seem like Johnson's telling the truth here. Indeed, the more Labour shies away, the easier it is to misrepresent us as wearing blue berets with gold stars on, singing Ode to Joy and pleading with the EU to take us back. I mean, I suppose it's kind of true, but the issue is that when certain Labour people do mention what they believe, such as this lady here, Anna McMorrin, saying Labour Party should rejoin the single market, it does kind of allow easy shots as well. What Labour need is a coherent plan to talk about what they actually believe in and what the path forward is for us. Kind of like a roadmap, what big companies do. In 2010, Labour chose not to talk about what Gordon Brown did to avert the financial crisis, which is true. That's a really good point here. The Tories keep taking victory laps about how they got us out of the pandemic and the recent economic problems, even though they're still ongoing. You know, they talk about record vaccine rollouts, world-beating furlough and business support, etc. I don't remember Labour saying anything about what Gordon Brown did to help alleviate the stresses of the 2008 recession. In 2022, voters still believe Labour maxed out the credit cards when such a thing is, when you control your own currency, extremely difficult to do. And again, you know, Labour did make a lot of mistakes back then in the wake of the crash. But, you know, the economic dogma was that the government really shouldn't get involved. You know, governments of the day shouldn't get involved when economic crises happen. And the Labour Party should have done a lot better, I think, during the crash. But at the end of the day, you know, no one really talks about what Labour did well. The notion that we were fiscally irresponsible became part of the British political folklore. And again, waging a war on the credit card, the Iraq and Afghanistan wars, wasn't a smart idea, along with some of the other things Labour did. But again, they are nowhere near the Blair and Brown governments are nowhere near fiscally irresponsible compared to the current crop of Tories we have. In fact, Gordon Brown and Tony Blair were arguably far more fiscally responsible than David Cameron and George Osborne were, Theresa May and Philip Hammond, etc. They were a lot better, those two Labour Prime Ministers. Without action now, any future Labour government will be hamstrung by the dogma that European means anti-British and our ability to achieve social progress will be stunned as a result. And that's a thing where, you know, the Labour Party could do better. You know, I don't know what the specific rules are around e-gates for EU countries. I think it's up to EU member states to decide who can use the e-gates and who can't. Maybe that's something where Labour Party can say, look, we can help try and resolve the queues at airports in other countries by coming up with deals with individual EU countries. We can get veterinary agreements, etc. We can do things to really help the country out here when it comes to all of the issues we're facing. But the Labour Party won't sit out its stall. It won't tell us what they actually stand for, which is incredibly frustrating. If they do this, then at least then when you come up with the slogan, make Brexit work, how are you going to make Brexit work? You know, you have to point out the problems first. Then you can explain the solutions. Anything else doesn't work here. So again, you know, the points she makes here are fine. Good points. Europe has been a useful boogeyman in British politics for generations, including on the left, which is true. The paralysis of the government in grappling with the Northern Ireland Protocol shows why this cannot be Labour's default option. The Labour Party have to, you know, at least show that they can come up with solutions regarding the Northern Ireland Protocol impasse. His government claims the impact of leaving the EU on food distribution prices are negligible. Farmers, retailers and families know the grim reality. You know, Brexit's having a huge impact on food prices. But again, you know, if the Labour Party don't talk about them, it allows the government just to blame it on other factors, global problems, COVID, etc. Again, you know, like, the Labour Party have to hold the government to account on these things, and only then can you argue make Brexit work. How can it be fair that our constituents are now paying more to feed their families, small businesses are struggling to import or export, and our children are missing opportunities, all while political elites still claim to be taking back control, just not yet? Bevan once argued, silent pain evokes no response. The same is true of silent politics. It will damage our national interests for generations if hostility about the UK working with the EU seeps into public life without dissent. Keeping shtum is not in anyone's interest except Johnson now. And again, you know, this article, I wish she spoke more about political strategy. If she said something the lines of what I kind of argued, which sounds a bit narcissistic, I know, but it's to say that, look, to make the slogan make Brexit work actually work, you have to point out the problems with Brexit first, with Johnson's Brexit, in order to show how you'll fix them. That's what I think Stella Creasley should have argued, at least in my opinion. But, you know, the criticism that she got from that specific YouTuber was really unwarranted, especially when he made the dumb argument, in my opinion, of saying we need to look at what swing voters care about. You know, honestly, do you know how to win over swing voters? You can change their opinions with policies. If these swing voters are, you know, people that go on holiday and they're stuck in a queue for 3 hours, you can talk about how you can resolve those issues. But instead, the Labour Party are just quiet. It's okay to look at what swing voters care about and incorporate that into your policy, but to only focus on them makes no sense. To be very critical of Stella Creasley on not offering much in terms of electoral strategy is dumb when, you know, if she does, it could undermine the Labour Party's broader policies. But I think she's right here in terms of what the Labour Party have to do, which is to talk about the problems with Brexit. And, you know, this isn't an op-ed about you know, how to win the next election or anything like that. What this is an op-ed about is that, you know, the Labour Party have to talk about the problems of Brexit in order to help resolve it. So I think, his criticisms were just really unfair. But anyways, I'm going to leave it there. Let me know what you think in the comments below. Sorry it's a bit rambly, it's just frustrating. Let me know what you think in the comments below. Like, comment, share, subscribe. Support the channel on Patreon if you can. And hopefully I'll see you in the next one.